Hi, my name is Claire, and I'm a PhD student in neuroscience at McGill. I study language and the brain, which is a combination of things that I love. I've always enjoyed languages. I grew up speaking English at home, but I was lucky to learn French early on through French immersion and spending time in France. French has definitely enriched my life and opened doors for me by giving me new ways to express myself, new people to meet, and new cities to explore, including Montreal. In high school, I started learning Spanish, and more recently, I tried to start learning Japanese, and it made me realize how natural it was to learn French as a kid, and how much more effort it takes to learn languages now. I was curious about this, and this brings me to my other passion, the brain. As kids, our brains are flexibly wired to be able to pick up new languages and skills naturally. As adults, this is harder, but the cool thing is that we now know our brains do stay relatively flexible throughout our lives, and they're shaped by everything we do. What I'm really interested in is how languages shape our brains. Languages can be funny and confusing things. Some words sound exactly the same, even though they're spelled differently. In English, this gives us sentences like, I'll come by to buy something and say bye. Or in French, you can get a sentence like, le verre vert va vers le verre. In English, we also have the opposite of this, where some words are spelled exactly the same, but they sound different depending on their meaning. This is why you can perfect something until it's perfect, contest the results of a contest, or record a record. Like you just heard, in some languages like English, we use syllable emphasis to tell apart some words that otherwise look the same. If I hadn't included those emphasis differences just now, it would have been hard to understand what I was saying. Other languages like French don't use differences in syllable emphasis to tell words apart, so some researchers have suggested that people who speak French have trouble hearing these differences. Today, I'm here to talk to you about a project that I worked on with other researchers in my lab, and the question we wanted to answer with this project was, how do bilingual people process differences in syllable emphasis? There's a lot of people in Montreal who speak both English and French. And like I was just saying, we know that syllable emphasis differences are more important in English than in French. So maybe bilingual people will be better or worse at processing syllable emphasis differences depending on which language they grew up speaking, or which language they're more fluent in. We thought that bilinguals who are native English speakers might be better at processing syllable emphasis differences, since they're more used to hearing these differences. Now, how can we study this? We could just get people to tell us what they hear, like by asking them if they can hear a difference between two words with different emphasis. But this might give away the purpose of the experiment and get people to pay too much attention to the emphasis differences that we're trying to study. So our results wouldn't necessarily tell us how well people can hear these differences in everyday situations when they're not paying specific attention to them at the lab. Also, what people tell us doesn't always reflect what's actually going on inside their head. Have you ever absentmindedly responded, yeah, when someone asked you something, even though you weren't really paying attention to the question? I know I'm guilty of that. So instead of directly asking people if they can hear syllable emphasis differences, a more subtle way to study this is by looking at people's brain waves. We can do this with EEG, which is a technique where the person wears a hat, kind of like a swim cap, super stylish, and the cap has electrodes in it that pick up brain activity through the skull. Some of the brainwaves that we can measure with EEG have been given specific names. The mismatch negativity, also known as the MMN, is a brainwave that shows up when you hear something unexpected. So it's a way for scientists to tell that you're surprised by what you heard. For example, I could play you a bunch of repetitive noises, and now if we could look at your brainwaves, we would see that you had an MMN when that last sound changed unexpectedly. The MMN is a fascinating brainwave because it shows up even if you're not paying attention to the sounds you're hearing. You could have been reading a book, watching a movie, or even fast asleep just then, and if I played you those same sounds, your brain would still have shown an MMN. The MMN lets us study what you hear at a subconscious level. In our experiment, we got people to listen to repetitive words instead of the repetitive beeps that you just heard. We used nonsense words, nocticity for English and dominogie for French, so that word meaning wouldn't influence our results. These nonsense words follow the rules of English and French sounds, so they sound like they could be words, even though they don't have dictionary definitions, kind of like the words in the Jabberwocky poem. People listened to the same word being repeated, and then once in a while the emphasis would change, so they might hear nocticity, 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 nocticity. And we looked at whether people's brainwaves showed MMNs when there was an emphasis change. All of the people in the experiment were bilingual, but half of them were native English speakers and the other half were native French speakers. We also estimated how fluent they were in each language by asking them to name as many words as they could think of in English and French for different categories. All of the people listened to the English and French nonsense words to see whether they processed syllable emphasis changes differently depending on the language that they grew up speaking or the language that they were more fluent in. So, what did we find? People did show mismatch negativities, or MMNs, in response to the emphasis changes, so their brains were surprised by the changes, as we expected. What's interesting is that overall, there weren't differences between people based on which language they grew up speaking or which language they were more fluent in. We thought that native English speakers might have bigger MMNs than native French speakers, because they're more used to hearing syllable emphasis changes. But it turns out that native French speakers were processing the changes just as well as the native English speakers, and they had MMNs that looked the same. Let's compare this to other research findings. Language researchers have often argued that if you don't start learning a language when you're a baby or a young child, then you won't be able to speak that language as well as a native speaker. But with this research, what's neat is that we studied a range of different bilinguals. Some of them started learning their second language as toddlers, but others didn't start learning until they were teenagers or young adults. And yet, overall, they all processed syllable emphasis changes in the same way. Remember that we looked at their subconscious processing by studying their brainwaves. So it seems like their brains themselves have been shaped by their bilingual experience to enable them to understand both of their languages. There's actually lots of other research backing this up and showing that learning new languages does shape the brain in really interesting ways. It can make some parts thicker or denser, more interconnected, more active, or wired for sending signals faster. You may not be aware of most of these changes, but when you learn a new language, you're reshaping and rewiring your brain. And it's not too late to start learning today. Our brains are amazingly adaptable, and what I love about them is that they're so incredibly intricate and complicated that there will always be so many more mysteries to solve about them. By studying language processing like I'm doing with the MMN, we can solve some of the mysteries about how our brains enable us to understand and speak languages. My hope is that eventually this will also help us develop strategies to make language learning more accessible and successful for everyone. This is a particularly important topic in today's era of human migration and multiculturalism, where languages are keys that connect us to new people and opportunities. So I'll leave you by saying that I encourage you to shape your brain and to open new doors through learning languages. Thank you very much.